Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Paratrooper Generals, Matthew Ridgway, Maxwell Taylor, and the American Airborne from D-Day through Normandy, by Mitchell Yockelson. Narrated by Jonathan Cowley. Preface. They couldn't do it. Not Matthew Ridgway, not Maxwell Taylor. They could not follow the path of other commanding generals who stayed out of harm's way, sent orders to the front lines from the rear, and polished their brass buttons with their khaki cuffs. They could not sit in the relative safety of their jeeps behind the lines. Not in Normandy. Not in the most important campaign of World War II. Instead, they chose to stand shoulder to shoulder with their troops. Ridgway with the 82nd Airborne Division, the All-Americans, Taylor with the 101st Airborne Division, the Screaming Eagles. Before daybreak on June 6, 1944, both major generals accepted the great risk of capture or death to drop alongside 13,000 other paratroopers into occupied Normandy. That day, and for the next 6 weeks, Ridgway and Taylor led their men, alongside their men, during fierce combat among the hedgerows, across canals, and through villages and city streets, eradicating German troops from Normandy. And when situations dictated that these generals could not fight side by side with their men, Ridgway and Taylor remained in constant contact, never far from the front. The paratrooper generals, Matthew Ridgway, Maxwell Taylor, and the American Airborne from D-Day through Normandy, explores in depth the creation of the American Army Airborne that led to the formation of the 82nd and 101st, and the significant roles that these two division commanders played on D-Day as they demonstrated extraordinary courage and leadership throughout the most important campaign of World War II. As West Point cadets, Ridgway and Taylor had learned that good army leaders should not only take a personal interest in the troops serving under them, but also lead by example. Both generals followed these maxims to perfection, and no two commanders were more adored by their men. During the months leading up to D-Day, Ridgway and Taylor were caught in an internal struggle with Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Force, Chief Commander, General Dwight D. Ike Eisenhower, and his immediate subordinates over the use of airborne troops for the initial attack. Their main sparring partner was Air Marshal Trafford Lee Mallory. The British Air Commander did not support troops landing by parachute before the Army's main thrust on the landing beaches. Lee Mallory, convinced that such an operation would be a total failure, foresaw exorbitant casualties. He suggested leaving the airborne divisions behind during the initial attack, and then bringing them in after the beaches were secure. The compromise was consonant with the original plan, which was handed to Eisenhower when he was appointed Chief Commander. That plan for the Allied liberation of Europe, known as Operation Overlord, was designed by a combined team of American and British officers. To them, the airborne landings were a mere afterthought to the infantry beach assault, with only a handful of British and some American parachutists considered as support to the amphibious landing forces. As Eisenhower familiarized himself with the early Overlord plan, he was at least willing to listen to a larger airborne component of Neptune, the cross-channel phase of the Normandy attack. Ridgway and Taylor refused to stand down. They argued hard in meeting after meeting to convince the strategists that without a sizable airborne invasion in order to secure Utah Beach before the landings, the entire operation could fall apart on the first day. Ridgway and Taylor, friendly but not friends, formed a strong alliance. They pushed back against detractors who lectured that an airborne drop in Normandy would cause more than 70% casualties. Perhaps higher, and they won the argument. Their thinking benefited from the support of Chief of Staff George C. Marshall and First Army's General Omar Bradley. Bradley's support took the form of a threat to call off the Utah Beach assault unless his infantry divisions had full support from the 82nd and 101st Divisions. During the closing hours of June 5, 1944, Ridgway, Taylor, and 13,000 paratroopers aboard 820 Douglas C-47 transport airplanes, the workhorse of the Army Air Forces, took off from airfields throughout southern England. C-47s, flying in V formations of 9 planes each, reached Normandy's Cotentin Peninsula 90 minutes later. There, they encountered intense flak from German anti-aircraft guns. As the planes approached the landing zones, the signal lights above the doorways flashed green. Jump masters ordered the soldiers to stand up, hook up, and jump out. Jump masters dropped first, followed by the paratrooper sticks, typically 17 or 18 men. Flying at a low altitude to avoid the enemy's radar, they exited the planes in many instances at only 400 feet above ground that was to have been marked by pathfinder lights and navigational aids. The airborne troops were part of US 7 Corps, commanded by General J. Lawton Collins. Their mission, codenamed Boston, 82nd Division, and Albany, 101st Division, was to capture Cherbourg, the coastal city in Normandy that would serve as the Allied supply port once the infantry and support units had come ashore later on June 6. Paratroopers were also responsible for blocking approaches into the vicinity of the amphibious landings at Utah Beach, led by US 4th Division, as well as capturing causeway exits off the beach and establishing crossings over the Douve River to assist the US 5th Corps in conjoining the two American beachheads on Omaha and Utah. A smaller contingent of British paratroopers, 6th Airborne Division, was also incorporated into Neptune. It jumped around the same time as the American Airborne Divisions. Its mission was to protect the left flank of Sword Beach by seizing key points, bridges, and terrain in an area about 5 miles wide and 7 miles deep between the Orne and Dives rivers. As important as these objectives seemed in planning for Overlord, all eyes were riveted on the 82nd and 101st Divisions that day. Ridgway's and Taylor's missions proved difficult and costly. Only part of the story is what occurred when just over 13,000 American paratroopers hit the ground, beaches, swamps, hedgerows, and trees. German resistance was immediate, depending on where the paratroopers landed. Initial casualties were high, and the deaths included a significant loss of commanding officers. More than a few airborne soldiers were immediately taken prisoner by the Germans, and their accounts of capture, and in many cases escape with help from French civilians, add drama to the story. Shortly after they landed, the paratroopers were met by gliders with reinforcements, anti-tank equipment, jeeps, and artillery. The gliders had an even more difficult time landing at the designated zones. They were like clay pigeons to the German gunners. The flimsy planes that escaped anti-aircraft fire still had to contend with obstacles such as poles and flooded marshland. The story continued to unfold when the elements from their division, which had been scattered far and wide, eventually linked up to fight as regular infantry, carrying M1 Garands and Thompson machine guns, Tommy guns. Fighting at battalion level, roughly 37 officers and 669 men, they eventually accomplished every objective assigned over a relatively short period of just over a month and a half. Ridgway and Taylor expected their men to be in action for no more than 3 days. They were supposed to be shock troops, stabilizing the areas behind Utah Beach to allow the amphibious forces to break free and then leaving. But they stayed in Normandy for several weeks and encountered daily combat. By mid-July, the 82nd and 101st Divisions had been relieved. so they returned to England. Statistics sum up a portion of their story. Of the more than 13,000 paratroopers who had dropped a month before on D-Day, more than 2,000 were killed and more than 4,000 wounded during the entire Normandy campaign. About 60% of the divisional supplies and equipment delivered by the gliders was destroyed when the planes crashed or ended up in enemy hands. The vast majority of Taylor's men had not previously seen action. The same could be said for some of Ridgway's troops. When they were withdrawn from the lines in July, however, they were battle-hardened veterans in two of the best divisions in the U.S. Army. Prologue, June 6, 1944. On Tuesday, June 6, 1944, at nearly 3 a.m, Chicago native Lieutenant John E. Peters landed Snooty, his Douglas C-47 Skytrain, on the massive 5,800-foot runway at Greenham Common Airfield in southern England. A few hours earlier, around 10 p.m., Peters had taken off from there with a stick, a Air Corps designation for a group of paratroopers of 18 heavily armed paratroopers from 3rd Battalion, 502nd Parachute Infantry Regiment, 101st Airborne Division. After a one-day delay due to poor weather, Peters flew the soldiers across the English Channel and over the designated drop zone, from which they jumped into Normandy, which had been held by Germans for 3 years. Returning to England after the drop, Peters carried two passengers besides his crew. The first was a moody and glum paratrooper who had lined up with the last half dozen soldiers to leave the plane. When his turn came, he had fallen, crashing into the rear door with such force that he was thrown into the back of the cabin. The men behind had shoved him aside to continue jumping. Wright Bryan, the other passenger, was a war correspondent with the Atlanta Journal-Constitution and an NBC radio stringer, freelance journalist. Later that morning, the charismatic 6-foot-5-inch southern gentleman who counted Gone with the Wind author Margaret Mitchell as one of his friends would make history broadcasting the first eyewitness account of the Allied liberation of Fortress Europe. Schaeff knew that all eyes were on the paratroopers, so the veteran journalist, who had been in Europe for 2 years covering the war, was invited by NBC London manager Stan Richardson to report what he saw with his own eyes. For the past 2 days, Bryan had been living with pilots and crews of the 89th Troop Carrier Squadron, 53rd Troop Carrier Wing, commanded by Major Clement G. Richardson of Salinas, California. Richardson's combat crews had been fully briefed as to their initial mission, the course they would fly, all procedures they would follow. Bryan and the combat crews lived behind barbed wire surrounding their quarters, protected by guards to keep them from any contact with outsiders. After Peters returned to Greenham Common and brought Snooty to a stop, Bryan climbed out and headed into the control room where he listened to C-47 crew interrogations. Then he went to the mess and ate beef stew and donuts, chased with a cup of coffee. From there, with journalist Demery Bess from the Saturday Evening Post, Bryan was taken to a waiting jeep and driven to London, 55 miles away. The chauffeur's erratic driving scared Bryan more than the flight to Normandy. Several times, he thought they were headed into a ditch or the Thames River. Entering London just before daybreak, Bryan felt his fear surge when he saw what seemed to be a paratrooper and his limp chute dangling from an overhead trolley wire. He wondered whether the Germans had counterattacked and shot down a C-47. Bryan had his driver stop the jeep. He shined a spotlight on the lifeless figure, but it turned out to be a cardboard dummy advertising some show or carnival. Bryan was dropped off at the Ministry of Information, MOI, office, located in Senate House of the University of London in Bloomsbury, where the nerve centre of handling war news had been established. The site contained a large newsroom for reporters, studios for broadcasting, and a war room draped in maps that only the 533 accredited SHAFE journalists could enter. A few people, most of them sound asleep in chairs, were there when Brian arrived. The quiet didn't last. At 9:32 in London, or 3:32 Eastern Wartime, Colonel Ernest Dupuy, a SHAFE press aide, read General Dwight D. Eisenhower's official communique announcing D-Day. Under the command of General Eisenhower, Allied naval forces, supported by strong air forces, began landing Allied armies this morning on the northern coast of France. The announcement brought a horde of press to the MOI newsroom, accompanied by high-ranking army and naval officers to answer their questions. Brian banged out his radio script on a typewriter in another room, 10 pages, double-spaced. At 4:15 Eastern Time, he went on the air for just more than 14 minutes, standing in front of the microphone, one hand cupping his left ear and the other holding his script. Barely pausing, Brian's rich southern drawl captivated listeners with prose worthy of William Faulkner. The first spearhead of Allied forces for the liberation of Europe landed by parachute in northern France, he began. In the first hour of D-Day by British double summertime, or a little more than an hour before D-Day began by Greenwich Mean Time, I rode with the first group of planes to take our fighting men into Europe. I watched from the rear door of our plane, named Snooty, as 17 American paratroopers led by a first colonel jumped with their arms, ammunition and equipment into German-occupied France. Before taking off for Fortress Europe, long columns of airborne troops trudging slowly under their full loads of battle equipment from the bivouac area where they had been camped awaiting this day, moved toward the planes that would carry them into battle. General Dwight D. Eisenhower, SHAFE commander, carrying the burden of the success of Overlord, codename for the invasion of Europe, visited with the paratroopers during the afternoon, quietly passing among the men and chatting with them, asking their names, their homes, and their jobs. Outside the door of each C-47, the soldiers assembled and checked their equipment, while ground crews and combat crews gave the plane a final tuning up. The paratroopers adjusted their packs, put on their May Wests, B-4 life jackets, nicknamed for the Hollywood starlet, inflated with compressed air, giving them an impressive torso profile, and chutes, and climbed into the planes. Each man was so heavily loaded that he had to be pushed from behind and pulled from above to mount the steps into the plane. Brian boarded last and spoke with some of the men, scribbling down their comments with pencil on sheets of paper or in his small pocket diary. Private Robert G. Hillman of Manchester, Connecticut, sitting farthest forward on the port side, proudly told the war correspondent, "I know my chute's okay because my mother checked it. She works in the Pioneer Parachute Company in our town, and her job is giving the final once-over to all the chutes they manufacture." Before joining the army, the blonde, blue-eyed paratrooper had also worked for a time at Pioneer. As Peters readied for takeoff, 29-year-old battalion commander, Lieutenant Colonel Robert G. Cole from San Antonio, Texas, the senior officer aboard and future Medal of Honor recipient, moved quickly up and down the passenger compartment, asking each man whether he needed anything. As the men settled into their bucket seats, Colonel Cole said, "The doc is going to give you some pills to guard against air sickness. Make yourselves as comfortable as you can. Better try to sleep a little." Brian noted that quiet settled in the plane. These men had done their talking. Now they were grim and silent. On the flight deck of Snooty, Peters and co-pilot Lieutenant B.E. Maxwell of Clave, Michigan, muttered soft curses as their motors were slow to start after long pauses on the taxi strip. But when the engines did turn over, they droned steadily and powerfully. "Almost before we knew it," Brian projected, "we were trundling along past the operations buildings and control tower where the ground personnel of the base were standing. Some made the V sign, some waved. Lieutenant General Lewis M. Brereton, 9th Air Force Commander, moved up and down the line of planes, giving the thumbs up sign to his crews. Then Snooty, marked like other C-47s with alternate white and black invasion stripes to prevent friendly fire, rolled down the runway. As Snooty picked up speed, Brian stood between the pilot and co-pilot and watched the formation lights of the ships ahead of them, slowly, almost imperceptibly climbing, then gradually swinging into wide circles. "This thing is really loaded down," Brian heard Peters comment out loud, referring to the fact that each fully equipped paratrooper weighed about 150 pounds, and nestled underneath the plane were bundles containing radios, engineer equipment, heavy weapons and ammunition, and rations and medical supplies loaded onto racks. When the plane became airborne, Brian could almost feel the sturdy transport strengthening its muscles, shouldering its burden. Then feet by feet, almost inch by inch, rising above the fields and trees of southern England. Brian had by then folded his lanky 6-foot-5-inch frame into the navigating dome's forward roof of the fuselage, often referred to as a dome glass blister or an astral globe. Snooty fell into a squadron formation of three Vs of three ships each in the first section, joined by Vs of three ships each in the second section, which led. The preceding squadron was already circling the airfield and rapidly gaining altitude. Other squadrons followed. Brian described the scene to the radio audience. All about us and below us was such a glimmering fabric of lights as I had not seen in the 8 months I had been in blacked-out England. Snooty circled the field four times, its runways and perimeter outlined in sparkling white lights. Through the sky, the red and green formation lights of the plane strung out almost to the limit of vision, looking for all the world like holiday decorations stretching down the length of any American main street. As the long procession straightened out on its pre-established course toward the shore of the English Channel, signal lights blinked in code, and navigators checked their speed and direction with the pilots, who were beginning the constant plotting of their position. As Snooty flew toward the coast, the bulky transport silhouetted against the sky as they greatly undulated in the prep wash of their companions. "Right on course, and we're 1 minute early," navigator Robert E. Taylor of Altoona, Pennsylvania, reported to Peters. At that moment, Brian left the navigating dome from which I had been watching the formations about me, too fascinated to feel the weight of the flak suit which I wore, like all crew members, or the steel helmet tightly gripping his head. Brian walked down the long passenger cabin to see how the paratroopers were faring. More than half had taken their colonel's advice and were dozing, their heads back against the wall and their feet stretched in front. Others were sitting silently, except for two or three who whispered among themselves. Brian had perspired in the crew's cabin up front, but back where the colonel sat, by the open rear door, with wind whipping in, he was glad he'd worn heavy clothing. More signal lights blinked as the plane pressed across the English Channel. The sea was calm, Brian described, its steely greyness blending in the half-light with the dingier grey of the horizon, but soon the moon brightened the water and made the ripples below us twinkle. The fuselage of a plane flew beside Snooty, outlined against the water, but its wings, obscured from Brian's vision, looked but for the high-tail fin like a giant whale rising and falling in the easy swells. Halfway across the channel, the planes, one by one, switched off most of their formation lights. Brian could see a few ships in the channel below, but could not be certain whether they were part of the armada carrying Allied soldiers to the beaches for the attacks that would quickly follow the first landings of airborne troops. Peters again muttered out loud, "Where is all this fighter protection we were going to have?" True, they had not seen a plane outside their own formations. But, Brian thought to himself, the fighters must have done their work well, for there was no sign of enemy aircraft either. "Tiny, tell the colonel it's 30 minutes till jump time," Peters yelled out, and Brian watched as the fat, husky crew chief, Staff Sergeant Richard A. Eberly of Indianapolis, the son of an Air Corps major, shouldered his way back to give word to Colonel Cole. Before he knew it, Brian turned his eyes from the occasional lights and flares which glowed on the Channel Islands. As he looked straight ahead, he caught his first glimpse of the east coast of France. "I had never visited the continent of Europe in peacetime," he stated, "and I was waiting for Invasion Day to visit it in wartime. The pilot and co-pilot too were seeing this coast for the first time." None of us spoke, but each looked at the other. Because of perfect navigation, they could now see the beach ahead, precisely at the point we had studied it on the maps, an aerial photograph, and on carefully modelled relief maps. Approaching the Normandy coastline, Snooty sailed straight into a thick fog bank. For the next 2 or 3 minutes, Peters flew blind, relying on his instruments to keep the plane on course. Emerging from the darkness, Peters was guided by a bright moon the rest of the way. By now, he had reduced altitude, so the plane was so low, about 700 feet, that, it seemed to Brian, the ground was almost close enough for the men to jump without parachutes. The small fields looked peaceful within their orderly hedgerows. It almost seemed you could see the furrows. Snooty met with only smattering small arms fire from the fields, which were dark and quiet as we entered enemy territory. Now the paratroopers were on their feet, each adjusting his pack and snapping his ripcord over the static line cable running along the centre of the cabin's ceiling. That way, each chute would open automatically as the paratrooper jumped through the door. Brian stood by the rear door. Over the roaring engines, he could hear Colonel Cole ask his men, "Are you all set?" Heads nodded. Another paratrooper hooked Cole onto the static cable, and he moved next to Brian. Suddenly, Peters flipped the jump switch light to green. The men began jumping quickly. In a matter of minutes, the empty plane flew back over the water, setting a course for home, while a few tracer bullets curved up to the side of us and behind us. Because Brian wanted to know how long it would take the 18 men to jump, he tried to count. 101, 102, 103, to estimate seconds. Before I had counted to 10 seconds, it may have been 11 or 12, but no more. "Our passengers left us," Brian said. That is, all but one of them, the one who had fallen. He was miserable, thinking his comrades might call him yellow, but the plane's crew assured him that the other men would think no such thing. As soon as Brian had watched the jumps from the rear door, tiny streams of tracer bullets were curving upward from the ground, but none hit Snooty. Perfect navigation had obscured the plane from known German batteries. Snooty flew over France for only 11 minutes. With the C-47 lightened by unloaded men and cargo, it streaked for home. Behind the plane, Brian could still see the tracers and an occasional flare below a few more ships. We couldn't tell what they were. Flying back over the channel to Greenham Common, Brian took his seat in the navigator's dome. He caught a glimpse of vessels below, ships probably loaded with troops storming the beaches. On Snooty's starboard, a continuous parade of C-47s headed in the opposite direction. The Battle of Europe was well underway. 1. General Lee's Airborne. Brigadier General Billy Mitchell was often found at General John J. "Blackjack" Pershing's headquarters. Ever since Blackjack had put Mitchell in charge of the air service during World War I, Mitchell stopped by unannounced every week, sometimes more than once. He mostly ranted to the American Expeditionary Forces AEF commander about the value of air power. The flamboyant, cocky, and outspoken aviator continued this habit until the army had suffered enough of his outlandish comments and booted him in 1925. Mitchell came by one afternoon in mid-October 1918, when Pershing was in a particularly foul mood. After 3 weeks of continuous combat, his doughboys were struggling at Mouzargon. Messages from the front told Pershing that their attacks had gained little ground. Casualties mounted. The other Allied commanders wanted Pershing's head, and he felt close to a nervous breakdown. Mitchell boasted that he could break the stalemate and asked Pershing to hear him out. Blackjack nodded yes and listened. "We should arm the men with a great number of machine guns and train them to go over the front in our large airplanes, which would carry 10 or 15 of these soldiers. We could equip each man with a parachute, so that when we desired to make a rear attack on the enemy, we could carry these men over the lines and drop them off in parachutes behind the German position." Pershing's reaction is unknown. Even had he approved, however, Mitchell couldn't have executed his scheme for at least several months. No parachutes were stored in the AEF stockpile, nor were there enough bombardment planes. 3 weeks after Mitchell pitched his plan, Pershing's doughboys broke through enemy defenses, driving the Germans back into Germany and ending the war. 134 years before Mitchell proposed the idea of airborne warfare, Benjamin Franklin, politician, inventor, scientist, and all-around Renaissance man, advocated airborne warfare after witnessing the ascension of France's first hot air balloon. "Why not launch 5,000 balloons capable of raising 2 men each?" he suggested to his friend, Dutch plant physiologist Jan Ingenhuis, in 1784, so that 10,000 men descending from the clouds might not in many places do an infinite deal of mischief before a force could be brought together to repel them. Franklin's idea, like Mitchell's, went nowhere, and parachutes continued to be used strictly for recreation. Who precisely invented the parachute, which led to 13,000 American paratroopers dropping into Normandy, is debatable, although the credit should most likely go to the ancient Chinese. Legend has it that 4,000 years ago, Emperor Shun escaped his father's attempt to burn him by jumping off a roof using 2 cone-shaped bamboo hats to cushion the fall. Vertical envelopment is far better associated with Europeans. In the 15th century, Leonardo da Vinci invented a parachute design. As Franklin witnessed firsthand 400 years later, the French turned jumping from balloons into a spectator sport. In 1785, noted French hot air balloon adventurer Jean-Pierre Blanchard threw a parachute-equipped dog over the side of his balloon. The dog landed safely and took off running with the parachute still attached. Around 1907, American Charles Broadwick devised his own method of parachuting. He jumped from underneath the balloon using a parachute folded into a pack, strapped to his back and opened by a static line attached to the balloon. Not only was Broadwick a daredevil, performing for large crowds at fairs, but, like the parachutists who came before him, he was also a pioneer. Finally, in 1929, the US Army briefly tested what Franklin and Mitchell had envisioned, exploiting parachutes for military operations. At Brooks Field in San Antonio, Texas, 3 soldiers wearing goggles and parachute backpacks climbed onto the top of 4 de Havillands, 2 pilot biplanes, and when ordered, jumped from the wings. Between the biplanes, Claire Lee Chennault, the future commander of the Flying Tigers, but then a training instructor at Brooks, flew a Ford tri-motor transport carrying machine guns, ammunition, water, and food, which were dropped where the paratroopers intended to land. The landings didn't go entirely as planned, however. Soldiers drifted over power lines or landed in mesquite trees. Yet in short order, the soldiers had reassembled at the designated landing zone and had the machine guns operational. None of this, however, impressed the Army's Chief of Staff, General Charles P. Summerall. On hand to watch the event, he was heard murmuring, "Some more of this damned aviation nonsense." Under his watch and the inaction of 2 chiefs of staff who followed, the War Department mostly chose to just watch as the French, Germans, Italians, and Soviets gave substantial attention to parachuting. That is, until General George C. Marshall was appointed to the coveted post in 1939. A brilliant, forward-looking thinker, Marshall was 59 when he took charge of the army, coincidentally the same day Adolf Hitler invaded Poland. Much like his mentor, John J. Pershing, whom President Theodore Roosevelt had catapulted from captain to brigadier general over 835 senior officers, Marshall became brigadier general, the army's highest-ranking officer, under the command of Teddy Roosevelt's distant cousin, President Franklin D. Roosevelt, who chose Marshall over 20 more senior generals. Born in 1880, George Catlett Marshall Jr. was raised 46 miles southeast of Pittsburgh in Uniontown, Pennsylvania. His father, who partly owned several coke ovens and coal fields, came from a long lineage of Virginians, including the first Chief Justice, John Marshall. Marshall was closer to his mother, Laura, than to his father. She was the opposite of her husband, who had a quick temper. She was both gentle and firm, Marshall remembered, very understanding and had a keen but quiet sense of humor. Each Christmas she placed a special gift for Marshall under the Christmas tree, and every year on his New Year's Eve birthday a week later, he could count on $10 from his mother. Marshall was a mediocre student. He loved history, especially stories about Benjamin Franklin and Robert E. Lee, while finding math, grammar, and spelling tough going. Approaching graduation from public school, Marshall weighed his options. College and military service topped the list. Attending West Point seemed a good idea. Before applying to take the competitive exam, he had to secure a political recommendation. Uniontown, a largely conservative part of Pennsylvania set in Fayette County, had sent a Republican senator and congressman to Washington. Marshall's father, an outspoken Democrat, told George Jr. not to even bother applying. So George Jr. attended Virginia Military Institute, VMI, in Lexington, where his older brother had gone, and where, many years before, Thomas J. Stonewall Jackson, a boyhood hero of Marshall's, had taught. Just steps from the school's gate, General Robert E. Lee, another of his heroes, lay enshrined in the Washington and Lee University Chapel. Entering VMI in September 1897, Marshall turned heads as a lean and gawky cadet, sensitive and shy, a Pennsylvania Yankee in a southern school. In the classroom, he floundered, but on the parade ground, he shined and was made first captain his last year. In Lexington, Marshall met Lily Coles. They married in 1901, right after his graduation. Marshall launched his long public career a year later as a second lieutenant in the infantry. He seesawed between assignments in the Philippines and garrison duty in the United States. Between overseas posts, he enrolled in Fort Leavenworth's Officer Training School, the path to advancement in the Army. To get through the rigorous two-year program, Marshall had to break his poor study habits, and in his second year, he was ranked number one in his class. Afterward, Leavenworth hired him as an instructor. When the United States entered World War I, Marshall became a G3 or Operations Officer with 1st Division and designed the AEF's first major battle, a limited but stunning victory at Contigny, France, in May 1918. General Pershing noticed and transferred him to American 1st Army. There, Marshall was architect of the war's last two operations, Saint-Mihiel and Meuse-Argonne. Not only a superb staff officer, Marshall was also noted for his loyalty and outspoken candor. One such example of Marshall's frankness occurred when he confronted Pershing in 1918, something few officers dared to do. During an inspection of 1st Division, Blackjack publicly complained that the unit was poorly trained. Pershing blamed its commanding general. Marshall stepped forward, placed his hand on Pershing's arm to prevent him from leaving, and corrected his boss. AEF headquarters was the problem, he declared, not the division. Startled by the audacity of the young officer and eager to escape, Pershing promised to look into the matter. There was no need to look into it, Marshall bluntly retorted. It's a fact. Pershing calmly replied that Marshall needed to appreciate the troubles his GHQ faced. Marshall, now growing angrier, fired back. We have them problems every day, and many a day, and we have to solve every one of them by night. Marshall expected a reprimand for his outburst. Instead, Pershing respected his openness and, from then on, took Marshall under his wing. After the war, Blackjack assigned him as his aide-de-camp. 20 years later, his star on the rise, Marshall continued to speak bluntly with his superiors. Summoned to the White House by FDR in April 1939, Marshall presented himself to the president, who said, "General Marshall, I have it in mind to choose you as the next chief of staff of the United States Army. What do you think of that?" "Nothing, Mr. President," Marshall replied, "except to remind you that I have the habit of saying exactly what I think. And that, as you know," he added, "can often be unpleasing. Is that all right?" Marshall remembered that Roosevelt flashed his famous grin and said, "Yes." Marshall, not happy with the minimal response, replied, "Mr. President, you said yes pleasantly, but I have to remind you again that it may be unpleasant." The president continued to grin. "I know," he said, but he did not add "George." When Marshall became chief of staff in September 1939, he piled his desk with attaché intelligence reports describing foreign armies' use of parachutes. The Russians drew the most attention. They had dropped more than 5,000 paratroopers during 1936 maneuvers at Kiev. 3 months after Hitler's invasion of Poland, the Russians went to war with Finland and were the first belligerent to exploit airborne troops in combat. The Russians were proudly ahead of everyone else in developing airborne troops, even inviting foreign military attachés to witness their maneuvers. Unlike his predecessors, Marshall paid attention to these events. He directed the Chief of Infantry, Major General George A. Lynch, to study the possibility of organizing training and conducting an air infantry. Lynch knew this directive meant right away. He replied in 5 days and told Marshall about 4 scenarios in which troops could be transported by air. Depositing small combat groups for special missions like blowing up enemy factories and munitions, delivering small raiding parties for reconnaissance, dropping combat groups to hold key objectives, and working side by side with mechanized forces. Marshall sent Lynch's recommendations to Air Corps Commander Major General Henry Hap Arnold, who had become an early aviation pioneer after Wilbur and Orville Wright taught him to fly in 1911. But Arnold had other priorities. He asked his Air Corps Board and Plans Division to weigh in. Several months passed before Lynch heard back. Even then, the response was lukewarm. Simply put, the board decided the Air Corps' meager resources were already stretched thin, and the Corps did not have enough air transport planes in its fleet. Marshall shelved the plan to use an air infantry for now. In a strange way, it was Adolf Hitler who lit a fire under the War Department to jumpstart its parachute program. He launched 2 successful airborne operations in Denmark and Norway in April 1940, and 2 others in Holland and Belgium the following month. Suddenly, Arnold offered Marshall a few transport planes, and Marshall then told Lynch to make air infantry a top priority. One of Lynch's most experienced officers on the infantry board, 43-year-old Major William C. Lee, took charge of the task. Later called the father of airborne, Bill Lee not only took this new instrument of war forward, but also refined it. Described by one historian as homely and lanky, Lee attended North Carolina State College, about 30 miles from his hometown of Dunn, where he'd joined the school's Reserve Officers Training Corps, ROTC. Second Lieutenant Lee graduated in 1917, and the Army assigned him to 3rd Division as a platoon and company commander during World War I. After the war, Lee stayed in the Army as an armored warfare specialist. Twice in the early 1930s, he went to Europe as an observer and peeked at Germany's airborne training program. This alone made him the most qualified officer to launch a similar project in the United States. In July 1940, Lee created a parachute test platoon at Fort Benning. 48 men, all volunteers, were divided into 4 squads that underwent a rigorous 6 weeks of 3-mile runs, calisthenics, tumbling, and hand-to-hand combat. They also had classroom instruction. Lieutenant William P. Yarbrough, one of the squad leaders, recalled sitting in Fort Benning's main theater with a half dozen other parachute battalion recruits. When the lights dimmed, they stopped talking and stared straight ahead. On the screen, a German newsreel obtained through American intelligence titled Deutsche Wochenschau. On the screen, a German newsreel obtained through American intelligence titled Deutsche Wochenschau, with Wagner's music in the background, showed in some detail the Third Reich training paratroopers. The opening scenes filled the screen, with undulating parachute canopies, Yarbrough remembered, drifting slowly like swarms of poisonous jellyfish across the field of vision. No dialogue, only a soundtrack that vibrated and thundered with Wagner's music as the Fallschirmjäger came to earth, slipped free from their parachute harnesses, and assembled quickly into fighting formations. Yarbrough and the others watched the film over and over. By the fourth time, they knew every detail, the boots, the helmet straps, and the aerial delivery packages. During the last phase of training, soldiers spent more than 40 hours learning to pack their own chutes and, over the course of instruction, jumped 4 times off a 250-foot tower. A fifth and final jump involved the entire platoon dropping from 3 aircraft. Once they reached the drop zone, DZ, the paratroopers seized enemy positions using weapons, ammunition, and equipment dropped in separate parachute bundles. On a warm day in August 1940, practically the entire War Department, including Marshal and Secretary of War Henry L. Stimson, flew from Washington to witness the event. Of course, Major Lee was also there. The jump was nearly perfect. Other than a couple of paratroopers drifting off course, the majority landed precisely in the DZ and quickly assembled their weapons to attack the objective with vigor. Marshall was so impressed that he declared the battalion be activated as a permanent tactical army unit the very same day. Before the end of September 1940, the training unit was designated the 501st Parachute Infantry Battalion. The wheels were set in motion for the eventual formation of 2 airborne divisions, one of which Lee commanded. General Matthew Ridgway, a Marshall protege, commanded the other. Major Albert Wiedemeyer, in the War Plans Division and the architect of the so-called Victory Plan, a blueprint for how the Army would mobilize and fight should it become a belligerent in World War II, calculated a powerful army to include 7 airborne divisions. While the United States made great progress with air infantry, even though it was not yet at war, the Germans regressed. On May 20, 1941, Hitler directed 15,000 paratroopers with glider support to assault the Greek island of Crete. This time, the results proved disastrous. Hundreds of transport planes and many paratroopers were shot out of the sky. 1,500 German soldiers who landed were killed by waiting British Commonwealth and Greek troops and armed civilians. Another 1,500 Germans were reported missing, but the British and Greek forces also suffered substantial losses. Of the 32,000 British Commonwealth troops and the 10,000 to 15,000 Greek troops, the British lost 1,742 killed and roughly the same number wounded, as well as 11,800 captured. Almost the entire Greek force was either killed or captured. After 8 days of intense fighting, the Germans took the island, but from then on, Hitler forbade further large-scale airborne operations. But Allied leaders vowed to learn from Crete. For the Americans, Chief of Staff Marshall in particular, it was a true wake-up call. It wasn't until after the war that the full extent of German losses and Hitler's reluctance to employ further large-scale airborne operations became known. Crete had represented the first time that a full division of paratroopers and glider units had been deployed in a single, concentrated operation. It remained the largest airborne operation until Normandy. 2. Matthew Bunker Ridgway. Future 82nd Division Commander Matthew Ridgway belonged on the battlefield and led his men from the front in Normandy. He belonged in the midst of his troops, sharing their hardships, discomforts, and dangers. James Gavin, who served under Ridgway during World War II, said this about him: "A great combat commander, lots of courage. He was right up front every minute, hard as flint and full of intensity. So much so, I thought the man's going to have a heart attack before it's over." But Gavin also worried about his commander. "Sometimes it seems as though it was a personal thing. Ridgway versus the Wehrmacht. He'd stand in the middle of the road and urinate. I'd say, 'Matt, get the hell out of there, you'll get shot.' No," he was defiant. Even with his penis, he was defiant. When another officer questioned why Ridgway put himself in harm's way, Ridgway replied that it won't hurt troop morale to see a dead general from time to time. Ridgway inherited his devotion to soldiering from his father, Thomas. The 1883 West Point graduate retired as a colonel after 36 years in the Coast Artillery. On March 3, 1895, during the first of Thomas Ridgway's two assignments at Fort Monroe, Virginia, his son, Matthew Bunker, was born. Typical of military families, the Ridgways travelled the country from one army post to another. Garrisons out west, where Thomas Ridgway commanded artillery batteries, were often the most primitive. They had changed a little since they were constructed soon after the Civil War. Ridgway's parents made an otherwise dreary existence comfortable for him and his younger sister, Ruth. Their mother, Julia, a concert pianist and art collector from Long Island, filled each of their temporary quarters with music and shelves full of books, while their father displayed love, respect, and kindness to his wife and children. They lived for 4 years at Fort Snelling, Minnesota. The quarters assigned to the Ridgways had been vacant, except for rodents, for more than a decade. Winters there were especially harsh, little helped by having only one room heated by a fireplace. Each evening, the family congregated around Julia, seated at her piano. The quartet sang loudly, their voices rising, according to Ridgway, above the shriek of the whistling wind that blew the snow in drifts against the doorway. In these remote parts of the United States, Ridgway learned to hunt and fish, his lifelong passions, from his father, from whom Ridgway also learned to love the open country in all its myriad forms. Matthew Ridgway learned from his family's peripatetic life that no matter where he was, mountains, plains, prairies, or seashore, he could make myself at home. In 1900, the United States became involved in the Boxer Rebellion in China. Thomas Ridgway left his family behind to go there with an artillery regiment. Returning after a year, he filled his son's head with rousing stories of American cannon fire smashing down the walls of Tientsin in northern China. As an army brat, Ridgway changed schools often. He started grammar school in St. Paul, Minnesota, and finished in North Carolina. He did the same thing with high school, starting in Virginia when his father went back to Fort Monroe and then graduating in Boston, where Thomas Ridgway led a coast artillery unit. Matthew Ridgway easily adapted to the army life he was born into. Waking up to reveille and falling asleep to taps seemed as natural to him as the sun's rising and setting each day. Yet he displayed only a minimal interest in joining the military, and his father never pushed him in that direction. Thomas Ridgway believed that a boy was an individual, a new being on Earth with his own traits of character and personality, and he should be allowed to choose his life work without interference. Ridgway, like most children, longed to please his father. For that reason, and despite his own slight ambition to become a soldier, he applied for appointment to the United States Military Academy in 1912. It remained to be seen whether he could pass the demanding entrance exams, since constantly changing schools had left alarmingly wide gaps in his education. He was especially delinquent in math, but Thomas Ridgway, an artilleryman, knew this subject well and patiently tutored his boy in the evenings. Young Matt still floundered, however, and remained exceptionally ill-informed in algebra and geometry. His parents then turned to Swavely's, a preparatory school in Washington, where other academy aspirants studied. The extra help did little good. Ridgway entered the academy around Christmas 1911, took his exams in May, and, to my bitter disappointment, he recalled, I failed in geometry. Back to Swavely's he went. For the next year, Ridgway studied hard, night and day, Saturdays, Sundays, and holidays included. I pored over my math books until I felt that Euclid himself would have been hard put to find a proposition that would stump me. His studying finally paid off. He earned a presidential appointment. He averaged 96 in geometry and algebra, a high enough score to best 13 other candidates. Walking onto the West Point plain for the first time on June 14, 1913, Ridgway looked like a model plebe, as first-year cadets were called. A biographer described Ridgway's hazel eyes as piercing, deep and wide-set, which accented a sharply chiseled and well-proportioned cheekbones and chin, a thin Roman nose, and remarkably unblemished swarthy skin. Standing 5 feet 10 inches and weighing 175 pounds, Ridgway affected near perfect posture. His athletic physique and huge powerful hands made him a natural at horseback riding, running, swimming, and playing handball and tennis. Besides his handsome physique, Ridgway's presence radiated toward everyone who encountered him. He'd come into a room, and you'd immediately felt it, said a close associate. He couldn't have gotten lost in a crowd if he tried. To the grinning first classman, his dashing good looks and rugged appearance meant nothing. They could hardly wait to introduce Ridgway and the other plebes to Beast Barracks. No sooner had he laid down his bags than he was plunged into 6 weeks of rigorous mental, physical, and spiritual testing. Ridgway never forgot that there is many a night when a man, sore and bruised both physically and emotionally, doubts the wisdom of ever having entered West Point at all. He certainly did. Each night while lying in bed during this anxious period, when a plebe's character is put to the test, Ridgway reminded himself, "Your father endured this thing, and thousands of other men went through it without breaking down. And if they did it, you can." Once the hazing ritual ended, Ridgway tried to make the most of his plebe year. He competed for varsity football but showed little aptitude on the gridiron, so he was cut from the team. While horseback riding, Ridgway was thrown twice into a wooden box painted to resemble a stone fence. During his second fall, while the instructor loudly pointed out his clumsiness, Ridgway suffered an obvious injury to his lower spine, although he walked away as if unharmed. Fearful of being dismissed from West Point, Ridgway kept quiet about the excruciating distress that made walking and sitting uncomfortable. Eventually, the agony dissipated but never completely disappeared, plaguing Ridgway for the remainder of his life. Once, while bending over a billiard table to make a shot, he felt the pain return with such force that he was brought to his knees. Another time, when he was on a training mission before the Normandy invasion, Ridgway hopped over a low fence and, as he landed, slipped on the icy ground, which shot a tremor of pain from his head to his toe. Ridgway continued to thirst for reading at West Point, where he devoted his free time to military biographies and memorizing Rudyard Kipling's poems. Thus, Ridgway behaved in exemplary fashion for most of his 4 years at the academy. His only disciplinary infraction occurred during the latter half of his first year. The commandant of cadets caught him inflicting a relatively mild form of beast barracks on a plebe. Ridgway was sentenced to a month of walking the grounds during leisure hour and a slew of demerits. During his last year at the academy, 1918, Ridgway was voted cadet adjutant and managed the football team. Because the United States had just entered the war and needed officers, West Point graduated Ridgway's class of 139 cadets 6 weeks early. He ranked somewhere around the top of the middle third of his class. His rank, considered only fairly good, prevented him from receiving first choice of service. Ridgway wanted the artillery, as his father had selected, but by the time his name was called for assignment, that branch was filled. He settled for infantry. Reflecting on that moment, Ridgway allowed that he had no regrets, not even for a moment that he ended up with the rifleman. Right after graduation, Ridgway married Julia Caroline Blunt in the West Point Chapel. Oddly, in his memoir Soldier, published 39 years later, Ridgway never mentions Julia by name, nor their two daughters, Constance and Shirley. The Ridgways divorced in 1930. 5 days later, he married again, this time in New York City, to Margaret Peggy Howard Wilson Dabney, the widow of a West Point classmate, Henry H. Dabney.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.